is really about trying to connect the dots between the different technologies that you heard about yesterday, other technologies that you maybe use on a daily basis, and we wanted like to look at the big picture and come up with a federation framework that would be powerful, usable, and would allow you to engage with peers. So before starting, I would like to get to know you, about know what you do and what are your expectations, and I would like also this session to be as interactive as possible. So if we speak about anything that relates to what you are doing or intrigues you or you disagree with, then let's discuss and make it as lively and as interactive as possible. So just to get started, who in the audience uses Docker containers like on a daily basis? Who never used Docker? Okay. This is good stuff. Second question about your use of public clouds. Who already used AWS and EC2 somehow? Who used other public clouds?
Microsoft Azure.
Microsoft Azure, yeah. So basically there are three big ones, the Google Compute Engine, EC2 on AWS, and Microsoft Azure. Fantastic. And then who uses tools like R in the audience? A few. Python, Jupyter? Okay, fantastic. Yeah, okay, so that's great. So the idea is the space, could it concern infrastructures or tools or technology actually for making use of these is extremely fragmented. What we want is to go after those problems of fragmentation and create like a federation. So this is the contract basically. So Rosetta Hub is a platform. It aims to connect clouds, containers, research software, real-time collaboration frameworks, and social portals. Basically, maybe some of you are members of ResearchGate. ResearchGate is great, put your papers and engage with others and find people with the same concerns. But what if we had a ResearchGate that actually doesn't only expose your papers, but expose your containers? And allow you to engage in real-time collaboration with peers working on something that is of a common interest? What if the research software you use, could it be on GitHub or elsewhere, could be accessed easily as a service from ResearchGate? Can we imagine a virtual environment for research and education that is like ubiquitous, that traps all of them and makes like R, Python, MATLAB, Skype, ResearchGate, Facebook, all merge all together into one single technology that would allow you to access easily those tools, interactively, but also programmatically, and potentially to have a marketplace which is where all the artifacts you may want to use or you may want to share would be hosted. So it's like a generalization of GitHub to something that goes beyond code and static files and start including services, containers, and everything related to the social interaction between peers. So what we would like to foster, the key capabilities that this technology is supposed to be delivering is first and above all, usability. Usability is key to everything. It's not good enough to have a technology that enables reproducibility if it's not usable. It's not good enough to have a technology for security that is not usable. In French, people say trop d'impôts tue l'impôt. Too much taxes kill taxes. Too much security kill security. Too much reproducibility, bits and pieces in all corners would make it useless. So we need something we need to find a balance between making things work for everyone and making things deliver what they are supposed to be delivering. So here, really, this is the key capability. Reproducibility comes next, but reproducibility needs to be wrapped in a way that you don't need to think too much about it. It should be there, it should be enabled, and Docker containers should be all over the place, but kind of hidden from the sight of the users who are not supposed to be geek or to use command lines or to do things that are maybe not the core interest of their research. Next capability we'd like to deliver is shareability. Shareability means that if I'm working and I'm producing an artifact, could it be a Docker container, could it be a Jupyter notebook, could it be just a data set, I would like making it shareable as easy as sharing a document on Google Docs. On Google Docs, you produce a spreadsheet. At some point, you would like to make that spreadsheet available. You go and say share, publicly shareable, and then you get a link. And that link allows you to go and say to your colleagues, this is where my data is. We would like this paradigm to be generalized. You work on a Jupyter notebook. At any point in time, you would like to make it visible on real time to your colleagues. It should be a link. Same for RStudio, same for ShinyApps, same for whatever relates to your data and relates to the work you are doing in data analysis. So we would like to deal with all the layers of interaction between scientists and their research tools and infrastructures. So basically, if you would like really things to be under control, to be reproducible, it's not enough to use containers. It's not enough to capture what you do when you interact with Python. We would like also to be listening on what's happening between you and the infrastructure. We need also to be listening on what's happening between you, your colleagues who work on the same thing, and the tools. We would like to really keep track. Oops, this is Visual Studio wanting to show something to us. Okay, so we would like really to be on the way between you and any change of the universe that you produce, so that we can record and capture and make what you've done later on reproducible, of course traceable, and of course auditable. So first episode of enabling usability. There is a lot of fragmentation in the infrastructure arena. There are so many clouds and so many ways to do computation. Amazon's public cloud is like the precursor, is the most mature technology, is the most widely used. Azure is improving, it's getting there. Google is also coming into this space and wanting a share of it. We also see research groups building their own clouds using OpenStack, Open Nebula. The researcher is facing this challenge of being able to talk to these different infrastructures. And they are all different in the way you interact, in the APIs they expose, in what they can deliver. So first step, in order to reach that metaphor of compute power like electricity, I would like to get to Amazon, it should be like a plug. Nobody has seen this plug so far, because that plug requires interaction design to make it happen. It's not enough that the compute happens somewhere else and that you pay for it per use. It's compulsory that plugging your computer to Amazon becomes as easy as physically going and touching your laptop to the electric power. So basically, what we want is create like a meta layer, a meta cloud. Something that sits on top of Amazon and on top of Google and on top of OpenStack and Open Nebula, and allows you as a researcher to use one interface, one place that rules them all, basically. A console that allows you the same way to run instances on Amazon, to run instances on Google, to control your local OpenStack, and potentially to control your local machine as well. So basically, moving from your local laptop to your local cloud to Amazon should be just frictionless and seamless, because they are controlled by a layer that is exactly the same. Where the friction has been absorbed, it's here, basically. We have created models that are supposed to map to machine instances on Amazon or Azure or Google, and to map to virtual machine images, and to map to containers. So this is step one. And of course, what you do from your console is also something that you can do through an API, because what clouds are about, first and above all, it's programmable infrastructures, scriptable infrastructure. It's something that you can call using a web, basically some code, in order to get things done. And that's a key capability, and that's a key feature towards reproducibility. So this is step one, a meta cloud of container on top of every single infrastructure that matters. Second step of usability is to say, okay, R is great and millions of users are happy to use it. Python is great and millions of users are happy to use it. There is like sometimes competition, but in many cases people use both. And also a little bit of Scala, they are doing some spot. And also sometimes other scripting languages, just from the command line. Some people use MATLAB, because for some use cases it's kind of the most powerful. So the real issue is what it's, that there shouldn't be like competition. We should be able to use all of them according to the need, to the use case, to where they can deliver better than the other tools. But what shouldn't happen is to suffer in getting stuff go from R to Python, or from Python to Scala, or from Scala to your spreadsheet, or from the spreadsheet to the SQL database. All that needs to be like wrapped in a way that makes data flow seamlessly. Example, I start working with R. I have a data frame, I'm working on it. So I produce some results. I would like those results to immediately become Python objects that I can start using without having to save and then load and try to think about formats and problems related to the differences between the object model in R and the object model in Python. So basically, we would like a brain that understands all of them all together. And that brain can understand that you would like to take your data from R to Python and do it for you. Do it in a very effective, consistent manner, and do it in memory. So that the idea is the following. We are gluing in one process the virtual machine of R, the virtual machine of Python, Scala, and we are, of course, connectors to SQL and to other tools that can be proprietary, such as MathLab. And we allow you to interact with each of them individually, or to get an API that would allow you to translate things from one to the other. The final result is something that looks like one converged environment, where you can switch from one language to the other on the go. So you do some Python and go to R, and then move back to Python or R or Scala or whatever, without having really any problems. The other need for convergence, the usability that is requested in those environments, this is a little bit complex. I'll show you what are the bits. This is part of the Rosetta Hub platform. I talked earlier about this broker, this part of the platform that is capable of interacting with different clouds. Could they be real clouds, or could they be just like clouds or clusters of containers? So this is the broker that is remote controlled by this social platform. This is based on an open source technology called LifeFrame. This is a kind of well-established technology, very mature, inside which you can inject components, they call them portlets. And those components actually will expose to the different end users various capabilities. So for example, here, as a researcher, you would like to get something done on Amazon. So you would access a component, which is the cloud console, and that component will talk to Amazon on your behalf through the broker. And the information that is sent by Amazon will be intercepted and will come back to your browser through this same infrastructure. These components, we have plenty of them, but it's extensible. So you can write your own, you can add whatever application you want. What is great about LifeFrame is that there is behind a very, very rich ecosystem of plugins and capabilities that you can just go grab and get into this infrastructure. What is also great about LifeFrame is that it has a security model and role-based access control that is very, very sophisticated. And the idea was to say, we need to leverage these capabilities of the social platform LifeFrame in order to make the interaction between people and the artifacts, clouds, containers, whatever, become something expressed in the terms of the social portal. If you are using AWS, EC2, or whatever, you go and you have a place for storage called S3. You create buckets, you put some data under that bucket. And now you'd like to share that bucket with others. You don't want that bucket to be public. You'd like to share that bucket with your peer collaborators and with your PhD student. How do you do this on AWS? You need to do something that complies with the security model and use the APIs of Amazon. They are complex. You need to define policies. You need to know what are the other users' identifications with AWS, the AWS account IDs. All that is difficult. It's clunky. It's not something that you would like to do, writing policies for sharing artifacts on clouds. What you would like to do is share as easily as you share on Dropbox, or share as easily as you share on Facebook. On those tools, you have groups, you have, and then you say, this document should be visible to this student, or this group should be accessing this artifact. We would like basically to put on top of these clouds and all the artifacts they can produce for you a way to make them shared and controlled and make their access basically manageable for everyone. So basically all you need to do in order to share a bucket on S3 is to go to this portal and say, this is the group of my students, these are their emails, and this is the bucket, please make them access that bucket. Then the system will go and talk to Amazon on your behalf in order to translate this requirement of sharing something, an artifact on Amazon, into policies and geeky stuff that you don't want to be touching on a daily basis. And what applies to a bucket on S3 and data storage applies basically to any artifact. If you have a Docker image that you would like to share, in the same way you would like to define a group and say, this group should be accessing this Docker image. Or if you have a Jupyter notebook running, you would like to control as well the access. So basically the idea is to have like a converged role-based access control that would allow you to rule all the clouds easily, but in a consistent and uniform manner. Okay, so basically we all agree on the virtue of containers and Dockers in reproducibility. But yesterday we heard from the speakers that Docker is the world is not Dockerizable. No. The world is also spreadsheets. The world is also documents. The world is also plenty of things. So can we, without saying one day Excel will disappear and people will be writing code from the command line, or one day there will not we will not need Word anymore. What if we say, can we bring the power of Docker to Excel? Can we bring the power of all those tools that we heard about yesterday to the front ends of the end user? So, for example, can we imagine an Excel spreadsheet where the computation, the data, the artifacts you play with are actually coming, the idea is to say, what if what we do in Excel was backed by Docker containers that will expose the formulas, that would expose the data, that would expose everything that is meaningful in that spreadsheet, so that the Excel spreadsheet becomes just a front end, something that exposes what is under control, what is actually controlled by Docker, but also potentially by Singularity or any other technology. So the idea is to say, I would like to have a data science engine, let's say, that runs under Docker and that gets controlled by Excel, and that data science engine will be having my formulas, will be having the way to produce my graphics. Could that be R or Python or whatever? Mm-hmm. So then, if I deliver that document, it's not anymore out of control, because basically behind the scene, there is Docker, behind the scene, there is R, behind the scene, there is all the controllable stuff that we like and that we want to use. And of course, these containers, they are portable and they will fly or move seamlessly from an infrasector to the other, from different basically places where they can become services and deliver something to the end user. Usability is also about allowing the interaction to happen from anywhere. We would like the front ends to the containers to be accessible from our tablets and our phones. And I don't know if some of you have already tried to use things like RStudio or Jupyter Notebooks or Shiny apps from mobile devices. That doesn't work very well, actually. They have not been built from day one to work in that kind of configuration. And being connected, living in a virtual environment where we engage with other, we have Docker containers sitting around and accessible to us and to our collaborators. The mobility side of things, of the front end is really essential. Another, like, piece in this puzzle that Rosetta Hub is delivering is a spreadsheet that can be mirrored to Excel, but that can be used in the browser like the Google spreadsheet. But the spreadsheet of Rosetta Hub has some specificities. Basically, it's a spreadsheet running inside the Docker container. The engine of the spreadsheet runs within the container and runs within the same memory as R and Python and Scala. So basically what you see in the browser is just what is in the memory of the Docker container. And then the cells themselves can contain not only numerical data or formulas, but can contain almost anything. Anything can be code. So you can write some R code and say, evaluate this code and inject the result in the cell A2. Or they can contain basically a mirror to your data. You say, the range B1 to D15 is going to be a mirror of my data frame. And then what happens to the cells impact your data frame, what happens to the data frames impact what is seen in the cells. I will show you a demo of this later on. But this spreadsheet actually is meant to say we shouldn't throw the paradigm of spreadsheets altogether. People like it because it's powerful. The 2D representations of data is powerful. Can we make it better? Can we enhance it by putting inside that spreadsheet some of the reproducibility things that we like? Can we make it connect seamlessly to the tools of data analysis and data science? Can we use it as like a universal notebook for all languages and all artifacts? And make all that shareable and accessible to people just in a few clicks and with simple URLs. So, now, yesterday we heard that Docker containers are not standalone, they require some glue to deliver something. So, the idea is the following. Okay, you have built a model using R, and on top of that model, you create loads of artifacts. Maybe potentially you create a shiny apps or whatever allows user really to interact with your model, and you would like to, someone to reuse it. The someone who will be reusing that can not do exactly what you can do, which means take the container and run it, and then go and see, open the port 8080, and then open a browser and connect things together. There's a lot of wiring that is not accessible to the people that you would like to share with. That kind of wiring, that kind of glue that needs to surround your Docker container in, for it to become usable, it should be automated in a certain fashion so that you say, this is my Docker container with everything inside, all the dependencies of my Shiny application, everything that my service needs are inside Docker. But then I have also scripts that would wire them, wire the tools that are inside. I have also visual widgets that can expose what is inside the container from a simple browser. And also something else that is needed if the end user to whom you are going to give your work cannot interact with Docker directly. It's potentially something that would allow the user to get the Docker container running, up and running, somewhere, on Amazon, for example. So basically, in this bundle, you put the reference of your image, it could be on a Docker Hub, you put your data on an S3 bucket, and then you put inside the bundle the keys that would allow the platform to create a container based on that image, wire things together, and give control to the end user. So basically, what this bundle is about, it's something that can make an application be delivered to someone who doesn't have anything, no knowledge, no access to public clouds, no familiarity with Docker whatsoever. They would just have the reference of this bundle, ask Rosetta Hub to make it become a virtual environment, and Rosetta Hub will do that. And you did it from your browser. The journal reviewer who is going to check what you have done will do it from his browser. There is just a label that make this become a real service accessible to the person who needs to assess what you've done. We talked about shareability. Shareability is about making artifacts, Jupyter notebooks, everything becomes a URL. Shareability is also about making real-time collaboration there. So your Docker container exposes a Jupyter notebook or exposes tools that you would like other people to access at the same time, the Google Docs way. We would like this to happen for every single widget or artifact that is built and exposed on top of your container. Could that be the spreadsheet? Could that be R? Could that be Python? So everything needs at any point in time to understand that there are more than one users accessing it and enable the kind of nice feature that you have in Google Docs to happen for notebooks and all the other stuff that containers would expose. So shareability is also about making people access things and find them easily. Here comes into play the idea of the marketplace. Basically, somewhere where what you produced, those bundles, the notebooks, everything, can be found and can be enacted, can become a real service at any point in time. We would like to build at some point like an eBay, where people find all kinds of things related to data. Shiny apps, notebooks from Jupyter, notebooks from Spark, whatever. They find them, in one click they can make them become real through the bundles that I have showed you earlier. And another idea related to the shareability is the platform can talk to Amazon, can talk to Google, can talk to any infrastructure, but actually you can hook your own cloud, your own Docker machine to this platform so that it gets controlled from this consistent framework and from these consistent and unified APIs. And if you do this, then the platform would allow you to share your compute infrastructures. You can say, I have a way to run containers for others. So the others can come and get this compute capacity to be used. And the process of enablement through this marketplace and through the platform. A final slide before switching to the demo and the real thing is about auditability. So people interacting with these data science engines and R and Python and Docker, we would like at any point in time to know if they are multiple users building the model together, to know who did what, basically, and when. Of course, version control is important, but if we are in a context of real-time collaboration where people can do things, we need a little bit more or something to be coupled with the version control. We need a database that tells what happened in this process of building a model while we have multiple users. So we have built the technology, and in order to kickstart things, we engaged with Amazon around the program for education. So what I don't know in the audience, anyone heard of AWS Educate? No. So basically, all the other vendors have similar programs, Google and Microsoft Azure. What this program consists of, you are an educational, high educational institution. You go and say, I'd like to register my institution with this program. And then every student is entitled to get a check of $100 of credits on Amazon, renewable yearly. And every researcher is entitled to get $200 of credits renewable yearly. And they don't put a threshold on how many students and how many educators, researchers would use this. So it's not something where you need to take any engagement whatsoever. Just say we are here in the program. And what we did, we said, this is great, because this is like the fuel of the platform. If we manage to get this Educate program to go everywhere and get people and students to use it, they will all start accessing public clouds. And if they start accessing public clouds, they can run containers on those public clouds, can use the platform. So we talked to the people from Educate and we said, we can do probably something together. You give them the money and we give them the technology that allow them to make that money become Docker containers, become tools for education, becomes tools for research. And we started exploring this together, and then we understood the gap, the technology gap that exists between things like AWS and students and researchers. AWS is a tool for IT people. It has not been designed to be something else. It is very, very complete, very, very sophisticated, but it doesn't deliver immediately. If a student needs to get a Jupyter notebook, the student needs to build it on his own. If a researcher needs an infrastructure, a pipeline for analyzing genomic data, the researcher needs to build it on his own. There's no help in doing that. That's one. Two, there's no help in managing how the students will get accounts on Amazon and get to use them in the context of the institution. So basically, many problems exist. You cannot expect students to put their credit cards to guarantee an account and take the risk, if they do something wrong, to receive a bill of $2,000. That's not something affordable, right? It's not affordable also to have students operating an environment where you don't have any overview, you don't know what happens, you don't know what they consumed, you don't know what they launched. There is a minimum need of monitoring, there is a minimum need of control that is not there. So we started building and adding to Rosetta Hub a framework for this purpose that at the end of the day became like an enabler of the adoption of AWS and potentially other public clouds in education. And then we contacted institutions and said, are you interested? And then we ended up today with around 50 higher education institutions who are into this. They don't do anything, we help them register to Educate, and then we give them the framework, they give us lists of students, and we have automatic tools that generate accounts, and then go and talk to the back end of Amazon and get the credit codes, and then you could put the credit codes on the different accounts, and we do the so-called consolidation. So instead of having each one having $100, it will be the institution that has the sum of all those small amounts. Then the institution ends up with $70K or something. That can be managed through Rosetta Hub. So it's not anymore Amazon who controls the budgets. It's Rosetta Hub that is looking at the consumptions of the individual accounts and checks the current consumptions against a threshold in the database. And if the threshold is reached, it disables the account. So it gives a lot of flexibility. So all the logistics for mass adoption of public cloud is put on the shoulder of Rosetta Hub, and the institution just basically chooses a manager who will take care of all these aspects. So this is how the Federation Console looks like. Basically, the student connects and gets a button here in the platform that takes him or her to the EC2 console or to all the tools that Amazon exposes. And then they start using all the services, could be ECS for containers, could be anything. But what is important is that the AWS account that you access is something that is connected to the others. So these are some of the figures. So in the platform currently there are over 40 higher education institutions, over 4,000 researchers. It's managing almost $500,000 of credits that is renewable yearly. And this is like just proof of concept. So the scale up is going to happen in the next fall, basically. And so let's switch to demos. So let me sign up. So in order to access Rosetta Hub, all you need to do is to go to www.rosettahub.com. So I'll take this and put it here. So that's the link. You can register. It's basically our model and where we would like to go is something like GitHub. But GitHub not just for static files and code and management of configuration management, but also about everything that we talked about earlier. So this is, you can, anyone, anytime can create an account here, the way you do it on GitHub. For today, I would like you to register on this link. So each time we register a new higher education institution, we create a link for them. So ucl.rosettahub.com, imperialcollege.rosettahub.com. So and then that link is used in order to register students or professors. Of course, there is a phase where we kickstart things with just a spreadsheet. They give us a list of students. Mm-hmm. And then we have automatic processes that we create accounts and send them just login passwords. But at any point in time, anyone can register. So those who are interested in getting right now an active AWS account that you can use to follow up or practice, those who are interested, of course, you just go to this link. And by opening this link, you will just need to provide some information. So it's really very, very simple things. So this is like an alternative to the registration process of Amazon Educate that is simplified and then that goes to our databases and then we kickstart a few tools in order to make the active AWS accounts be created for you. So really hardly anything to fill in. It's very, very simple. Once you have done that, we will have a monitoring tool that will allow us to say now create the active accounts for these people, And then you receive an email that says your active account on AWS has been created. This is the login password. And the login password is, of course, the login password to Rosetta Hub. So rosettahub.com. So those who would like to try things out, just go and register here. Okay. So now let's start step by step looking at the platform and how it relates to all those different capabilities that I presented earlier. So I'm going to connect to rosettahub.com. So sign in. So in the first slide, we mentioned the creation of a console that can remote controls all the infrastructures. Could that be Amazon or Google or Azure or whatever? So here you see a part of that console. On this console, so you have a dashboard that would look familiar to anyone who used EC2. It's like similar in terms of interaction. So basically, you see here that currently I have two machines running. I have no clusters. I have so every machine has one container, one Docker container, and have plenty of other artifacts that do not have a counterpart directly on those public clouds. So let's see how to run a new machine. So I will go to machines. So currently, I have two of them. I will click on launch.
You need to register to be able to see that.
Sorry?
We need to fill out the registration.
So basically, the registration, there are two ways. There is the basic Rosetta Hub account, where you register directly from the website. You go to rosettahub.com, there's a link join. And that link will take you to a registration form, very simple, and you get the account on rosettahub.com. The other link, C4R, this is for getting something more complex, which is not only an account on Rosetta Hub, but also an account on Amazon with credits, so that you can run machines on Amazon right now.
So what you're showing right now requires that set of
No, the console, no. But if you need to run a machine like I would do right now, you see here, I have keys. Those keys are linked to an active AWS account. So when you create an account directly on Amazon, you need to bring your keys. So basically, the platform is a broker. It gives you a console, but in order to do anything, you need to register keys to a real infrastructure. In order to register keys to a real infrastructure, you need to have an account that is active on Amazon or Azure or Google or whatever. Here, we propose to give you an active account. You see, so that's where the C4RR.rosettahub.com comes into play. We use that process for a higher education institution. We created the virtual organization for the workshop. And once you have filled in the form, Latifa will trigger the process of creating the active account, and you will receive an email with the login password to Rosetta Hub.
Can it do this now?
Yes, please. Whenever you it's done, it's going to be processed. So that's one thing. You would like to take a couple minutes? It's very easy, actually. Mainly your email, your first name, your last name.
No, so,
yeah, just put anything on what is not appropriate. Because these are targeting students.
And professors.
And professors, yeah.
And nobody else.
Yeah, basically, it's for, yeah. Put whatever. Say, well, I am a professor.
one.
The
there's
I will wait a minute just for those who would like to. Yeah.
Not well designed.
You don't like it?
Well, the only title in the land is professor, assistant professors, and then course level, graduate level.
Those are the information that are asked for by Educate. Because we need to take this information and give it to Amazon. So we have just to ask for what Amazon requires. So that, the level, is about potentially the course that is going to be given using cloud technology.
So it's not for research then, it's not for researchers?
The program is not for researchers. There is a program for researchers called the AWS Research Program. But we are using this because we have already the pipelines for creating active AWS accounts. That's like, of course, the other alternative could have been to use the spreadsheet with the information and just feed it into the platform. But I apologize for the inconvenience. But the information that needs to be accurate is mainly your email address, and that's it. So when you are done, so wait 30 seconds or so, we will go through this simple process of allocating a new resource, a machine, on a public cloud inside which Docker will be operating. And we will run that machine and take control over the Docker container from our browsers. So, So let me just go back in order for you to follow me. So basically, I logged in. I'm on this so-called advanced console. I was on the dashboard. The dashboard shows me the current resources I am using on the different clouds that are accessible to me. I selected machines. I could see that there are two of them running at the moment. I have a button launch, and that button will take me through like a simple workflow to provision resources on any cloud to which I have access. Okay, so I need to close this one. So the first step in order to create something is to say to Rosetta Hub, what keys are you going to use? So these keys need to be pre-provisioned and linked to an account on Amazon or Azure or Google's cloud. So you go to security keys and you register. You say, this is my access key ID, this is my secret access key, and please call it my EC2 keys. Then it gets registered in Rosetta Hub, and then you can use it to launch. This is, yes, questions, please.
I would rather like follow your presentation when I have my login.
It's being processed as, where are we in this? Okay, so it will take a few minutes.
Yeah.
In the meantime, of course.
I looked on the Holy Grail that you're trying to sell here. Can you tell me more about the business model behind it?
We would like to create something like GitHub. So it's GitHub is behind it, there is a company. But it's one of the most important technologies for open science and open whatever. So that's our model, strictly and exactly. It will be completely free, like GitHub. But for those who would like companies who would like to use it internally as their own GitHub, they would have to subscribe. But education will not pay anything. All those institutions in our energy, we are doing it for free. There's no money involved in this process. And the aim is not business comes second. We would like really to create a new ecosystem that is like the GitHub ecosystem, but goes a little bit further in terms of enabling services components rather than just code. So that's one fold of the answer. The other fold of the answer is that idea of marketplace. This basically currently you have marketplaces on clouds, public clouds, Amazon, whatever, that where you can put virtual machine images, and that's not something that people can use. We'd like to create a space where everyone can put stuff to be shared freely or potentially to be sold one day. That's not something that we are doing. If one day it becomes a real marketplace where people sell their shiny applications or their Jupyter notebooks or whatever they produce on top of data infrastructures, so those transactions could be like on eBay, transactions with the commission. So this is it. The another part of the answer, which is, because this is very important, another part of the answer is the following. It's not, again, it's, we define ourselves as social entrepreneurs, so basically it's impact comes first, and we are not backed by VCs, and we will not. So basically, all the control of the strategy and technology and everything related to this new space we are trying to foster is controlled by just the two of us. And so, and that's where we can commit on things like this. Our interaction with Amazon is we are building, it's something that is helping them and helping us. It's like a win-win deal, where we are not committed in any way. We are keen actually to work with other public cloud providers as well around the programs for education they deliver. And we have maybe moved forward with Amazon because the APIs are today the most mature, but we are also looking at the APIs of the other cloud providers. We have already in the platform centers like the LRZ, the London Supercomputing Center. They have a private cloud based on OpenGL that is accessible from the Zeta Hub. But of course, that is exclusively used potentially by their own users. So what we would like to do is, again, to foster a new ecosystem and to make impact. That's the key message. Does this clarify?
Yes.
Thank you. Yes. So, who received an email with login password so far? One person. Two? Three?
I have nine.
Nine should have received. Okay. So basically, I'll tell you one word about this pipeline for creating these accounts. So those who already created an AWS account and has put their credit card for that account, now how complicated it might be to interact with the infrastructure and how risky it could be. You just close the console and go on holidays and come back, and you find that you've left three boxes running, and that means a few hundred dollars that you have to pay without having made any use of it. The console itself is a little bit not optimal. Basically, you can be working on a region, you have resources, and switch to another region, and you don't see any more of those resources of the first region. You think you have zero, and actually you have something hidden that runs on island, and you are looking at the London data center. There are problems that relate to the fact that you cannot easily go to Amazon and say, I don't want my consumption to exceed $50. There are like services budgets and whatever that allow to do something, but they're a little bit tricky to use, and they don't work if you are not directly paying with your credit card, but with a credit coupon. So if you receive a coupon for research or a coupon for education, then you cannot put those thresholds. That's why we introduced all these capabilities in Rosetta Hub, to provide that monitoring of budgets and to be able really to know exactly where you are at every point in time. Also, what is not accessible directly on Amazon is things like auto-stopping idle machines. So you would like, if you forget something, you don't want to have it running for 3 months. You run a cluster, a Hadoop cluster. Amazon cannot tell that you don't need it anymore. So that's gonna keep running until you explicitly shut it down. So we have, by actually this these kind of safeguards that we introduced that allow you to say, this stuff needs to be stopped automatically and don't touch it for more than 3 hours. We have added those safeguards progressively while watching what students are doing. So basically, they don't they have access to this sophisticated cloud console. They click and close it and go home and forget things. This comes from the fact that it is complicated, but this comes also from the fact that they don't realize that when it comes to public cloud, we are not anymore in the Google kind of apps where everything is free. You know, if you use Google apps, you don't pay for your spreadsheets, you don't pay for your documents, you don't pay. And so basically you do whatever you want, you create them and then forget about them and go. Here, no, it's you are paying for every single action. So there is like an awareness or a culture of switching off the light when you leave the room that needs to be there progressively. But in the meantime, we need to put safeguards in order to avoid credit depletion that can happen very, very quickly. So by having the one thing that is important is that you know, one of the barriers of adoption of this Educate program was the fact that institutions are required to put their credit cards, and students to put their credit cards. And that was a no-go for almost most of them. You know? So the idea was to say, okay, we have created this technology that can monitor everything, can know at every single point in time almost how much money has been consumed. So we will say, the master account that will receive all the budget will have our own credit cards. So basically, we are taking the risk, but it's a controlled risk because we are watching what's going on. This was like compulsory because if you tell them you need to take the risk, nobody lets that. Basically, it's not a regulation also does not allow this. So the master account. If something goes beyond the credits, goes to our credit card. But because those credits are kind of enormous, when I say enormous, just the Department of Computer Science of UCL, we have $70,000 of credits. That's a lot. You know, before you end up using $70,000, a lot can happen. So basically, that's like one level of guarantee for us, and also we are confident in the technology, so we know that at every single point in time we have the information. How do we have the information actually? That's not something that is accessible from the API of Amazon and from the API of any cloud provider. Actually, it's all you can say to Amazon is, this is an S3 bucket. Please, every time you compute the cost of everything I'm doing, all the machines, all the storage, put all the detailed billing files here. So they have batches, batch processing that runs, and every now and then provides those huge files. So when those huge files arrive, that there's a Lambda function that is triggered. What is a Lambda function? Anyone knows what a Lambda function is? So a big thing. So basically, on Amazon there is a service where you can say, this is some code in Java, in Python, in JavaScript. Please execute it under these conditions or when this event occurs. So it's the concept of microservice, if you want. So what happens, Amazon takes your code, and every time something is supposed to trigger the code execution, Amazon does it for you, but it does it in a secure and highly scalable fashion. So if the events triggering the code happen a million times, there will be a million executions. You don't need to keep the server running for that. They will just give you a number on how many times your code has been triggered. They will tell you it has been triggered a million times, and that would cost you $0.50. Something like that. You don't pay for compute time, you pay per execution, and the price per execution is very, very, very close to zero. So what happens is the information about the billing comes, is provided by Amazon, telling that you have used the ECS service, the container service of Amazon, for this period of time. And then that information is parsed by a Lambda function that we put on the master account. The information arrives, we take all the details, we parse it, and then we push the parsed information to our databases. So immediately we have an information saying, on the account of this institution, this user consumed $0.50, this user consumed $1, the global institution account consumed this much. And that's where we start comparing with thresholds that you can update any inside the database. So as an admin of your institution, you will say, this student works on a project that requires more than $100, I will increase the limit. So instead of having 100, he or she will have 200 or 300. So that's how it works. And this is for knowing what happens in relation to cost. How do we know what happens in relation to usage of resources? We use Lambda functions as well, but not inside the master account, but in every single account. So basically, the account you will receive and will use later on is an account where our pipeline have injected functions, that Lambda function, that will react to any creation of resources inside AWS. So you launch a new server or cluster that says to the Lambda function, wake up, there's something. The Lambda function goes and screens how many machines that you have started and push the information to Rosetta Hub to say, this user currently has two machines running of this capacity and a cluster. So then we have a kind of global overview of what is being done that is exposed to the admin of the institution. So as an admin of your lab or your department, you can see that there is a student who is running currently 20 machines. Maybe there's something wrong. Maybe he forgot to switch them off. Basically, that kind of monitoring is really important. So that happens on the account.
So basically, most of them that file in booking, I think the limit on the number of accounts has not been
included
by this report. So not to call.
Yeah. So basically, there is a work. So who received an email so far? Okay. So basically, that's more or less the number. Those who didn't receive the account, potentially Amazon will lift the limit. Basically, the master account, we use it through something in Amazon called organization. It's a service that is like 3 months old. That service allows the creation by API of accounts. But they put a limit on how many accounts can be created at once. We created it, we opened its support ticket to increase that limit. It normally goes too quickly, but it took more than about 48 hours. We will try to get this done. Those who didn't receive the email can always use the link Join of Rosetta Hub. I show you the link. And we will share keys with you so that you can launch as well. So I'm going here to the so if I sign out, you see there is a join now link here that doesn't give you an active Amazon account but gives you access to Rosetta.
So that's a separate account with a different password.
Sorry?
That would be a separate
account.
Yes,
that would be a separate account. Yeah. No, normally you should use another email address.
Yeah.
Normally.
Or I can get the passwords from the database. The ones.
They have already accounts.
Yeah, it's just the AWS.
Five accounts is manageable.
You need to be
So basically, The drawing now is something that you can use anytime to create any number of accounts, basically. If you'd like to check what your students will be seeing, then you can create an account as if you were a student and then see what happens when they will be accessing the tools. So here we go. So I'm signing in. Okay, so when you sign in, normally you get to what is called the Federation console. So who already managed to connect and see this? One, two, three. Okay. Yeah, so I'll very, very quickly tell you what you are seeing here. So this is basically that framework that connects to the information about costs and about resources and the information about what you have consumed so far is available here. It says spent and remaining. This is a special account. This is mine. It's not connected to any credits from ours. So at the end, this will go to our credit cards somehow. So basically, you will have information about how much you spent, normally zero. And when that information has been updated, because it's not real-time information, that information is provided on like a cycle by Amazon. And so here, this is where you see how much you spend and how much is left. This is where you see how many resources have been allocated on Amazon for you. So here, the number of machines running, the number of machines stopped. How the volumes storing data, the snapshots, these are the virtual machine images. And at any point in time, you can click on the button, and this will go and talk to the Lambda function inside your AWS account and tell the Lambda, please push again the information about what is going on my account. This is the one important thing. This is the button that takes you to your AWS account. So does that work? If you click here, oh. So who managed to access the AWS console? One, two, three. Okay, perfect. So the AWS console looks like this. So basically, you have the different services grouped into categories. This is the category compute. This is actually the most important service. This is where you launch machines. But this is also very important, the EC2 container service, ECS. And S3 is also an essential service to know. So basically what you have received is an active account with all the services enabled, but on that account there are policies that restrict you. So basically you can do exactly what I would be doing here, go to EC2, and start a new server. So here I'm going to say, okay, launch a new instance. I will choose an image. We'll choose a capacity. These capacities are linked to memory and disk size and so on and so forth. I will ask for just one instance. I will specify the size of the disk of the machine. I will not tag it. I will say review and launch, and launch. Okay, I will take these keys, launch. So it's not the purpose of today is not to do it specifically what I have done. It's just to show you what people do with Amazon. Go, click, 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 and they get server running. And then they can connect to it and do whatever they want with it. So that's something that you would be able to do with the active accounts that you have. So this is the new server that they have just started. You see, it's already running. That's something that you can do with the active accounts, but it's not for any capacity. Basically, the pipeline that Latifa triggered has created what is called on Amazon an IAM user. So basically, it's a user with a policy that says what that user can or cannot do. And in that policy, we have restricted you to certain capacities. There are instances on Amazon that allow you to have 2 terabytes of RAM into one machine. That costs like $20 per hour. That's not something that you can use. But the manager of your institution can allow this. So the manager can go to the tools for monitoring and say, this user should access this capability. What happens when you go through the workflow and say, I'd like to run this capacity, you will have an unauthorized message saying you cannot do this. So, how does the console of AWS link to Rosetta app? So, as I said, what you received gave you access to the Federation console. From the Federation console, you have the button that takes you to the realm of Amazon, but it's a realm of Amazon that is sandboxed, controlled, supervised. And then you have under this button the multiple other ways of interacting with Amazon. So here, you see, this is the access, this is my console I have hidden there. So basically, this is the access key ID, this is the secret access key, this is the default region, and this is the account number. So this information that you have that is specific to you allows you to interact with the cloud, create machines, containers, or whatever, from programmatically, from the Python command line, from Java, from whatever. They have what they call SDKs, software development kits, that by taking these credentials, would allow you to go and run or create resources as much as you want. And this is from Rosetta Hub. These are links to those bundles containing keys and container images and that recreate an environment in one click. These are the safeguards. So for example, this is the auto stop. So you can enable it and say for how long the machine should be running without doing anything before it gets stopped. It gets stopped by the Lambda function once you enable it. So the relation between this and what I've been showing you earlier is by switching from the Federation console to the advanced console. If you switch to the advanced console, then this is where you get that simplified workflow that would allow you to run a new machine. So this is the button. What happens for the accounts that you have received now, there are keys that have been provisioned. So these are, it's a Rosetta Hub mapping to real keys on Amazon. So I will use this workflow to create a new server. So first step, I will say which keys I am using. You see here, I have also keys on OVH. I have keys on the LRZ OpenBibula Cloud. I have keys on Google. So if I take the keys of Google, I will be running stuff on Google. But everything looks the same, whatever cloud I pick. So here I'm going to choose Amazon. Here, there's something important. When you run the container and would like to connect to it, the connection needs to be secure, right? How is that connection going to be secure? There is a need to deploy an SSL certificate inside the container. Okay. That's something quite geeky, and you need to generate private keys and get them signed, and that costs money, and that's not something that a researcher should be doing, basically. But it's essential. You cannot afford interacting with containers without SSL and without a valid SSL connection. Here, what came to the rescue is a service called Let's Encrypt. Have you heard of Let's Encrypt? Who didn't hear of Let's Encrypt at all? Okay. So basically, Let's Encrypt is like a consortium that created an authority that signs SSL certificates for free. This is number one. And it's an authority that signs SSL certificates in an automated fashion through APIs. So basically, we connected Rosetta Hub to this service so that every user anytime can get a valid SSL certificate in the database of Rosetta Hub that will be injected into the container so that the connection is protected properly. As a user, do you need to do something about it? No, because two things. One, we generate the certificates if needs be, but also we allow the certificates share. So if someone owns a certificate, he can just make it available to you. So if you are in a relation of trust with other members of your group, you can just have one certificate. That certificate can protect one or many domains. So this certificate I'm going to use here is a special certificate called the STAR certificate, which protects any subdomain of RosettaVM.com. That's a valid certificate that will be used. You can use it as well, it's shared with you, but it's not protective enough because many users will be using it. It's for convenience, but if you'd like something seriously protected, then you go to security and you generate a certificate. You say, okay, I will protect this domain, and Rosetta Hub will go and talk to Let's Encrypt and sign the certificate and inject the signed stuff in the databases so that your container will have them. Okay. So I have chosen my keys that defined my cloud. Now I give a label to the machine. I will call it demo 2806. Okay. So what am I supposed to choose at this level? The image. So this is an image that has all of these tools already. Not on the image, within a Docker image inside the virtual machine image. So basically, there is a Docker container that will be created when the machine is kickstarted, and it has these tools, and you can at any point in time snapshot either your container or the virtual machine image and basically start from what you have left. Basically, you can launch this machine, it has all these, you put your data inside, you put the R packages you need inside, and then click the button snapshot, and that creates a new one that will appear next time in the combo box, and that allows you to start again. Who can use that machine image? Only you by default, but you can go here and say, I would like this image to be accessible to this group of students or to these researchers. And that makes it possible for them to use their keys to run a machine based on what you have created that contains your R libraries and data sets or whatever. So at this level, I'm giving a label. I'm choosing my image. I'm choosing a capacity. You see here, I have only two capacities. This is a when you create the keys, you can restrict the keys. You can say these keys operate on AWS in this specific region, and they allow only these two capacities to be used. Why this is good? This is good because the idea of Rosetta Hub is to create wrappers around everything needed to operate on an infrastructure and to make those wrappers shareable. What does this mean? So my students don't have an AWS account, but I would like them to be able for the duration of my exercise to run machines. All I need to do is to create a new key and share it with them. So they can run machines, they will find that someone shared keys with them, and they run with those keys. So it's like a mechanism of delegation. I give you the keys of my car, you use it, but after 2 hours, everything will stop. So you need to bring the keys back. So that's how it works. So I'm going to choose large. I'm going to say I don't need the machine to be auto shut down. I will shut it down manually. I can stop at this level and say review and launch. So basically, you see, there is a new machine called the demo 2806 that is pending. It goes from pending to starting. It's the capacity is too large. You have seen that the update of the state happened in real time. How that works? Basically, within the account on AWS, this Lambda function that is triggered every time the status changes of any resources you are interacting with, the Lambda function is triggered. The Lambda function will talk to Rosetta Hub and says, the machine is not anymore pending, it's now starting. And that information gets to your browser through a real-time channel. So basically there is a WebSocket permanently open towards Rosetta Hub, and the Rosetta Hub receives real-time notifications from the public clouds that come to your browser or come to the Python package, basically. And that's not something that you get directly from public clouds. There's no such a thing like real-time notification coming from Amazon. Okay, so now the machine is starting. And I will choose to connect to one of the machines that are already running. So here, I will connect to the engines. So you see here one of the ways to interact with a container that has been created inside that machine is this virtual workbench. So this is a virtual workbench. This is running in the browser. This is not VNC or RDP. This is pure HTML5. And this runs on iPad or anywhere. And I can ask to get widgets to make use of my container. So this is a very, very simple widget, which is a console that allows me to interact with any of the personalities of this multi-language data science engines I talked about earlier. So I can talk to R, I can talk to Python, I can talk to Scala, whatever the engine understands. And all that will happen within the memory of one same process. So I'll interact with R. So basically, this is like an IDE for R, like another R studio that needs multi-language. And something important about it is that it is fully programmable. So it fits within a framework where not only you can get these graphic devices mapping R code, but you can get basically all kind of sophisticated widgets for visualization, all kind of tools that contribute and help you in your process of looking at the data. So there are widgets that are very generic. So I will ask for the following widget: tools, BNC. So this is a VNC connection inside the container that I have that has been created when the machine was kickstarted. This VNC connection allows me to do anything. I can have root access inside the container and install whatever software I need. Of course, within this container, I can run, if I have a license for MATLAB or if there is like a server for a floating license of Mathematica or whatever, then you can enable those tools straight away here. So basically, you can configure a container, put all the software, and your students or your colleagues just get access to VNC. Do they have we configured anything? No. If all the wiring happened automatically, have we dealt with security and single sign-on? No. It has been taken care by Rosetta Hub. Have we deployed SSL certificate? No. It has been done by Rosetta Hub. So basically, the user just click, gets things done, and work in the browser. So this is one widget. There are other widgets. So I will close this one. I will ask for another tool. RStudio maybe is not enabled in this one. So let's see. So this is Jupyter. So Jupyter is running inside the container, and I'm accessing it through this widget. I can say I don't want to see the workbench. I'm interested only in Jupyter notebooks. So I can change the personality of the container. I can say this container only shows Jupyter. So I go here and say I will reconfigure the container so that it becomes purely a Jupyter notebook. So I'll go to settings. Okay, now I will refresh. So basically I don't see anything but the Jupyter notebook. Now I will reconfigure the container to become just pure VNC. I will say okay, go. Maybe we can try RStudio on this one. Tools. Yeah. So this is RStudio as a widget. Basically, all of them live in the same container, and all of them, in each one of them, is a different perspective on things. So I can do something in RStudio and then move to Jupyter. The data is there, and all of them share the same container, and the time I snapshot it, I snapshot all the dependencies. Every package I installed through RStudio, everything I done with Jupyter will be there. So if I would like to have the container becomes pure RStudio, I will go to say, okay, the container should be configured to become a pure RStudio. So here we go. Settings, default perspective. It could be Shiny, it could be Zeppelin, it could be whatever. So configure container. So now the container is just RStudio. Of course, this is
good to supply data to your container if I get 10 gigs data to process.
Yes.
Yeah,
so that's an interesting question. There are two answers. The first answer is all this would run in a virtual box machine in your lab, and you will control things the same way. So basically, and we have a technology that even if you have a firewall or something, it will still allow the management to happen from our platform to your lab. Then you don't have to need to move anything. But ideally, your data would be sitting somewhere in the cloud. And the platform allows you to create a container as close as possible to that data. So if that data is on Google's cloud, we will go to Google Cloud. If it is on Amazon, you will go to Amazon. And the idea is the following. You could start with that virtual box doing things on the local data, but if you don't have any more any capacity for doing that, you should be able to migrate. And migration here is very easy because you can snapshot and get things to run elsewhere under the same conditions and with the same interface. And that's important. So basically, what you can do here is go connect, say, the containers I'm going to prepare for my course should have, by default, the RStudio perspective. And they should, and I will install on the container all the packages, bioconductor, whatever. And then, after doing this, I push a button, I create a snapshot, and then I go to Rosetta Hub, I create a group with my students and share the snapshot with the group. They arrive, they find that in one or few clicks, they recover everything that has been created by you as being the baseline. So that's important, and that's, we heard yesterday about Jupyter being provided using Kubernetes and things like that. There are various institutions who are doing this, but there is like the bottleneck is scalability. You cannot do something like this on your own infrastructure. If you have thousands of students who have different needs, who need these students need to use Hadoop, and these students will work with Jupyter, and these students will work with RStudio. You cannot imagine provisioning an infrastructure that would allow all of them to work together at the same time. That can only happen on Amazon or on Azure or from Google's cloud. So in order for this to happen on Amazon or Azure, some technology needs to help you in creating the baselines and in managing the interaction between you and those who will receive your container. So this is the idea of, okay, reproducible is good. I have a container image that capture everything. I have also some piece of code that will wire things together, but it has to be accessible quickly, easily. So if I go and read the paper, and I have at the end something that says, this has been produced using, let's say, this particular Docker image. It's on Docker Hub or wherever. That's not good enough. I should go and click and get the virtual environment where you have been working and start using it. I have no time to go and download and wire things myself and secure things myself. And that's what Rosetta Hub is about. Yeah. So, coming back to the virtual workbench, so I will switch perspective. Parent container. You see here, I am looking at an engine. This process that has multiple personalities. That engine lives within a container, and I can manage the container from there. Basically. So. This is an interface to Docker, basically. I can say, parent container stop, parent container start, parent container commit. And I can manage the parent machine. So I can stop, start, snapshot. So what I'm doing here is just reconfiguring the parent container. Here we go. So workbench. And of course, here I can enable or disable any of these because they take memory, and I may want to save that memory. Okay, configure container. I'm going back to the workbench view. So, in this workbench view, I will I'll close this one here. And I will ask for a console, a graphic device. I will, this is a different container, so I will define X again. I will ask for an histogram of X. I can, I can use floating notebook sets. What are these? This is like a notebook cell that you can position anywhere. and that can contain any language. So for example, here, I'm going to ask for a variance of x. Okay, I will get some Python code, and I will use it. So I take this Python code here and go back and ask for another notebook cell and say this notebook cell now is Python, and I will execute that code. This is the result of the Python execution, and I can carry on. And actually, inside one of these floating cells, I can alternate, can write some R and say now I'm Python and now I'm Scala, and go back to R. And there are functions that allow you to pull the data from, for example, you are in Python, you get the data from R. Say, get me the data frame they have created in R into Python, or the opposite. So I can do things like this. So here I'm going to my console again. I will define, I will switch to Python. And I will define an array in Python called y. And I will switch back to R. And I will say, OK, now please bring the variable y. And this is the context. The context defines the process from which the variable should be taken. Yeah, it's Python. Did I do something wrong? Let's get okay. Yeah. So basically, the get object is a function that is available in R, that is available in Python, and it, I don't know if you can read, like you can zoom in. So basically, this is what I've done. I defined a variable in Python, and then I asked in R, this is an R function, to get the variable named y. And the context in which this variable is defined is Python. You could do something for Scala or whatever. Maybe we stop here, get a break, and then continue later. So shall we continue a little bit further? So normally the missing accounts have been created, and who didn't receive any mail so far and was expecting an email? So everyone is fine with the accounts. Very good. So I will connect as the admin of C4R, and to show you how the supervisor of the institution sees or overlooks the. So I connect as the CPOC stands for central point of contact. This is like an Amazon terminology. C4R. Name as the CPOC of C4RR. So this is what the supervisor sees. So basically, these are the resources currently used by all of you. There are 8 machines running and 1 stopped. And we can drill down to see each user by user what's going on. So we can go to users. So the current costs are all all stills are not. This is just you. But they are zero because basically there is a cycle. We will have the information about what your operations costed, like in a couple of hours maybe. And let's look at the instances. Yeah. So basically, Arno has two. John has two. So basically, this is like an eagle view on everything that's going on. And at any point in time, we have the possibility to say, okay, I will change the budget of Arno. So I will say upset budget. So it's not going to be 10, it's going to be 15. Apply. So that sets the limit. The limit becomes 15.
You can the higher limit, okay.
Okay. So I will decrease. So, okay, so budget. It's not 10, it's 9. Okay. Yeah, so that's the new limit. And if you reach the $9, then what happens? Your account will be disabled. So basically, we'll go to that IAM user inside the AWS account. And we will attach a deny all policy, and we stop the machines. So that's, of course, we don't delete data, we don't remove machines. Then you can go and talk to the CPOC and say, I would like to keep going. So the CPOC adds budget, and then you can restart your machines and keep going. The actions that the CPOC can do are all of these. For example, this is part of them actually. So enable, disable, you can stop an account anytime. You can reactivate an account anytime. You can update emails. You can go and overlook the console of the user if you are authorized. You can change the allowed EC2 capacities. You can change the Elastic MapReduce capacity. All that can be done from this interface. But what is important is that all that management and all this information is accessible with an API. So basically, you can write Python code to manage the infrastructure, change the budgets, look at the consumption, take actions, implement policies on top of your users. So I really do encourage those here who are eligible for Educate. So this doesn't apply to just the research lab, but this applies to a department where any kind of education is given. So if you have plenty of PhD students, that also sometimes can be considered as education. So just apply. How to apply, actually? There are two ways. You can go directly to the AWS Educate website, apply, and then come and register to Rosetta Hub as an institution, or do it straight away from Rosetta Hub. I'll show you how. So if you go to the Rosetta Hub, the main website, there is, and scroll down, there is a link here, application for institutions. So that link, basically, is where you provide information about your institution and yourself. And we take care of registering you to Educate and to Rosetta Hub, and we do everything we have done for C44R, and we can take the list of your students in a spreadsheet, the Excel spreadsheet, and register them, and everyone gets up and running as quickly as you've seen earlier today. So, yeah?
If my institution is already
a member of Educate, you can register it for if your institution, well, what institution is
UCL,
your?
I guess.
Ah, UCL is part of it. So you basically, you go to ucl.rosettahub.com and put your name, and then you'll receive an account. That's all you
need. Without checking my, because I'm not an educator or a student or
anything. It's so far so good. So basically, at UCL, currently, it's only about the computer science department. We received the list of all the students, and they are already in the platform. But it will be generalized. But currently, the link is active. It normally, you should be able to put your name. is it active? UCL.resultan. Yeah. So if your institution is not there, then you should have approval from like head of department or someone, because it implies that you will be considered as part of the educate program, and that's not something that you should be doing on your own. You should inform the colleagues and anyone authorized. Okay. So, but it's easy. Once you have done that, you'll have, if you have hundreds of students, that will translate into $100,000 that you can use however you want, and that is renewed every year.
The university
is built
for this?
No, it's money that is given to the university. It's not you who... It's the other way around. And believe me, for education, these amounts of money are enormous. If you consider that there are machines that cost like 1 cent of a dollar per hour, can imagine what you can do with $100,000. It's way, way too much for education. You can end up using a fraction of it if you have big data, master's degrees, and people are running Hadoop clusters, then maybe. But for normal use like, you know, Python notebooks and some GPU instances and some stuff here and there, some projects, you will use maybe 10% of the money you would get. So anyway, so let's quickly, so this is being sent. But I really do encourage you to give it a try, because there's nothing to lose here. Okay, so let me get rid of this. Going back to go to console. So I showed you what the view of the CPOC of C4RR is. Here you can define groups, you can access a wiki and a forum. You can see your artifacts on AWS and share them with others. So you can define a group of students and say this S3 bucket should be visible to this group of students, and then you take care of all the policies and everything in a kind of updated way. So you add the user to the group and you update the policies immediately. Okay, so we are connected to Redmine, so you can open support tickets and things like that. So let's move back to the advanced console. I would like to show you the sharing. So here, cpoc.c4rr is a user with whom I would like to share this work I have been doing. So all I need to do for sharing is to go to share and say, I would like the user cpoc.c4rr to be able to access my session, and these the rights I will grant to that user. I can put user or groups I share. So basically, you see here, there is a new user that this is quite similar to the Google Docs sharing thing. So here is the sharing link. So I can send to cpoc4rr this link, and he will be prompted to log on, and then he will be accessing exactly that container, that virtual environment. I will do it right now to see how this looks like. So share, done. Okay, now I will go to the other browser and go to shared engines. I see that there is this AABB machine that has been shared with me. I will connect to it. And basically, I find myself in the same virtual environment, and we can start collaborating. So basically, let's make this smaller here. Yeah, I will update the Python code. type ls in the console. Here I will grab this graphic device and do some annotations. So this is like real-time collaborative. Basically, this is not just the device of R. This is multi-layered remote collaborative device on which we can do many things interactively or programmatically. And basically, this real-time collaboration can happen between any number of users. And how we handle that, this is something a key aspect of Rosetta Hub, is that the machine that takes care of the collaboration is not our platform, it's your machine on EC2. So if you take a big instance and inside it there is a container that has enough memory, then it could be thousands of users potentially able to work together or access together the same thing. This is one important aspect. The other important aspect is that the access to the engine, collaboratively or not, is also possible programmatically. Let me see if I have, maybe my R package is not updated. Let's give it a quick try. So here I'm going to connect, this is a standard R command line. I loaded a package called Rosetta Hub. And I'm going to connect okay, it's printing me for password. So I'm getting a session, so I am debug mode. So what happens here? The R package called Rosetta Hub talked to the Rosetta Hub platform and asked for a session. Now I have control over the platform from my local command line. What I can do is show me all the containers, or show me all the engines, or attach this particular storage to that particular container. So here I'm going to say, for example, platform get private engines. I will put this in a variable E. So E contains, it's a data frame that has the three machines that I have started. So I can have a look at, yeah. You see the machine demo AABV is the third one. So if I do this, so this is basically the third engine. I will create a connection to that engine. I will say, okay, platform dot connect engine. So I'm asking for a session to that particular engine. Now I will ask R to start listening on real time on the events coming from Rosetta Hub and from the engine. So those are the events that have been sent early on. So now I will tell the engine to show me the variables that that it has. Yeah, there is variable X, that's the X that have created earlier. I will go and show you X. Actually, X is there. So the variable X is this one. I will bring it to my local R. This is just because there is an event that has been triggered. But I will make the remote X go to a local X. Get object. And basically this X became a local variable. I will do the same thing with from Python. So here I'm going to define a variable y in Python equal 4578. I will execute this in the notebook cell. And I will go back to my command line. And now I will set y in R by doing a get object on the remote engine and by saying that the context should be So I'm saying, from that particular remote engine, bring the variable x, y, and put it in from Python and put it in y. So this is y in that became an R variable. And that applies to anything in Python. And that could apply to any environment that works in that engine. So from your local command line, you can think of this as an extension of your R. R becomes, like, through this client to Rosetta Hub, capable of doing things in any language, in any infrastructure, in creating containers, connecting to containers, sharing containers. The number of functions when you type engine dot or platform dot is almost 800. And those functions allow you to interact with the platform, interact with the social part of it, define groups, share groups, create and manage the life cycles of machines, engines, clusters, and also interact with this, the lowest level of granularity, which is the Python R Scala engine. Now what I would like to show you is this. So here in this framework, I will do the following. I will create interactive widgets that will show my variable. So here I'm going to define a variable n in R equal 12. And I will ask for a way to interact through a slider. So here I'm defining a slider that will be a mirror of my variable n in R. I could do the same thing with a variable in any language. So here it's n, and it will be from 0 to 1000. Okay? So I have that slider here. If I change the slider interactively and ask for the value of n, n changed accordingly in R, and if I do something like this from the command line of R, it changes as well. This is like another way to do reactive programming. Those who are familiar with Shiny know that there is a way to bind, but it's declarative, and you deploy, R is blocked, and then, you know, if you'd like to update something, then you stop, rebuild again. Here, nothing is stopped, and the interactivity and the interception of event is wired like magically. It works only by having sandboxed R in order to make it trigger events when things change internally. So for example, if X changes or N changes, that trigger an event that is intercepted by the widget that is told to update, and vice versa. So how can I update N? I can update it from anywhere. So this is, of course, collaborative. If I put this side by side with the other, there we go. So on the left you have CPOC C4R, and here it's me. And all my actions are broadcasted real time. And now I can do things from the local R command line, because here I have a client toward that same engine. So what I'm going to do is to say, okay, let me have a look at N. So N is 200, and okay, I'll redefine N locally to become 133. And I will push N. So I will say engine.putObject. So my action, you see the slider moved to 133. So anyone who talks to the engine can update variables, and that triggers event to anyone listening. I will go one step further. I will define a macro. I don't know, those who use Excel and use VBA, that is a little bit similar, but this is just pure R code. So here, or pure Python, I will go to tools, data, macro, basic macro. I will create a macro which condition is any change of the variable n. and which action, so if the condition is fulfilled, then the action will be defined here. This is code, and this is the context of execution of the code. So here I can say process equals Scala and send something to Spark. Or I can say process equals Python and get Python to do something. Here I will keep the default context, which is R, and I will define a new variable z, for example, as being a function of n. Let's say, there we go. So each time n changes, this code will be triggered. So let's change n and look at z. Z changed again. Now let's ask to see z as like a bar chart. So this is a representation of my variable z. If I trigger a change of n, z changes real time, and if I trigger that change from my local R command line, so I will say n equal 45, put n. So that's how it works. So it's like a generalization of Shine to become multi-language, but also to make the reactive programming extremely easy. Shiny still requires some geeky background for someone to create things declaratively and test them. Here, it's real-time collaborative. It's done for R, but the same code will do the same thing in Python or in Scala, and it's something that can be shared in one click. So this interface can be delivered to the world through a simple URL. So let's do that. Here we go. I will say share. I will share with public. So basically, once the sharing is enacted, this link normally will allow. Okay, so this link here, I will put it on the slide. So basically, if you use this link, bit.ly2tj.w4.8u, should bring that interface. Look at the interface. Is it being publicly shared? That's what you should have caught. So basically, you open the link, you get just the interface, I can pay with it. Yeah. So again, this is the idea of shareability. I create the container, it has dependency. Instead of having these widgets and macros, it could have been Shiny, it could have been a Jupyter notebook, it could have been a Spark notebook, and configuring those things is extremely easy. So and now I will show you something important. I can push a button and save everything I have done to a database that is a local database, that actually was capturing every interaction I have done here with this environment. So I can go to the database and see all my actions that changed the variables and who did what and when. Now what I will do is, after snapshotting this, I will create a token. So I will go, so I will go back to here, and I can say there is a project save. I will someone that did something. Who is playing it? So basically, yeah, so what I'm going to do now is go to my console and go to issue. Yeah, someone is playing the slide. Yes. I will go to issue tokens and show you how I can package all the elements that can reconstruct the environment for someone. And I will say create, okay? And first step, this bundle I will deliver to my student or to someone I'm collaborating with, needs to be connected to keys. Those are the keys that will reconstruct things on a public cloud or a private cloud. So here I will use those keys. I will use the same certificate. I will give a label. I will call it course A. I will take this image. I will take this capacity. I will say that the duration of execution when someone acquires this bundle is 3 hours. Then afterwards, the machines are shut down automatically. I will create 10 of these, okay? And I will do next. Here, I can specify the reference volume. Here, I can say the description of the virtual environment with all the widgets and everything and the shiny apps and hotel is on this S3 bucket. So these are S3 buckets on Amazon that received a save from the workbench. Okay, then I can say, if they have multiple container images on that machine, I can pick the specific container images I'm interested in. I can add startup scripts. So I can say, when the machine starts, send this to the container, to Docker, send this to R, send this to Python, in order to get things started. For example, I can send to R a command to start, to kickstart the Shiny server, for example. And here, I define the settings of the container. So I say, the container will have the default perspective workbench, that's where you can see the widgets, or the container will have the default perspective, I don't know, RStudio. Okay. So here, the default perspective is workbench, okay? Next. Here I will say, who is going to benefit from this these tokens? These tokens, I will send them to the marketplace. So I will be the owner, or I can get the owner being my student or someone. So I'm the owner of this token. Okay. Next. Create. So basically, I have created that bundle that contains the Docker, the definition of the Docker images, the definition of the init scripts, the definition of the cloud keys that will get the Docker container to be created, everything that will reconstruct the service. And then I bundled that and called it a token. And that token can be given to anyone, and that person will find it in Rosetta Hub, will click, and that reconstruct the environment. Instead of giving it directly to a person, I will put it on the marketplace so that people can buy it. Buy it for free, I will put a zero price on it. So here I will say, please sell this token. The price is zero. The product name is Course A. The category is Rosetta Hub Apps. I will take an image, this one, okay. Sell. So that action is saying, this token is now not anymore an issue token, it's a product. So I will connect as, so this is, I will connect again as another user, let's say CPOC. I'm signing in, and here I will go to the marketplace. The marketplace is accessible from this link here, and it's accessible also from the front page. So by going to the marketplace, I will find that someone has put a product. that product is actually a compound of various things that deliver a capability. That capability is a Docker container that exposes, you see, this is course A, okay? So I will say, I would like to acquire this this container, this compound. So it's in my shopping basket, check out. So I'm going through a process that is a standard, you know, e-commerce kind of process. Here there is an order confirmation. This is what I would like to buy. The total is zero. If the total was not zero, it could have taken me to any procedure of payment. So basically the user who sells the token that reconstructs the Chinese app could put his email address with PayPal, so that the money is really received through this process on the account of the user who sold the Shiny app. So confirm order. So I just asked as cpoc.c4rr to acquire that token. Yeah, the order has been processed. So now I'm going back to my console. So in tokens, I will see that I have acquired a token called Course A. So I can select it and say, I can select it and say launch. And this will reconstruct everything I will get in the browser that interface with Slider. And I can do this from the basic console. So you see, this is the token. I can make it bigger. So these are, this is a token that I acquired through an order on the marketplace. So you see how streamlined is the process. So the current existing marketplaces are about virtual machine images, and that's way far not enough for normal users. You know, you give me a virtual machine image, and so what? I need my Shiny app. I need my notebook. I need. It's not up to me to go from that image to what. But here, we have delivered everything. The idea of this marketplace is not just to deliver a bundle with all dependencies to reconstruct or reproduce something. The idea of the marketplace actually is to progressively expose all kind of capabilities that would manage the interaction or the exchange of value between two individuals in the data science space. What that exchange of value can be. It can be sharing a Docker image. It could be sharing just some data sets. It could be sharing a way to run a machine on Google's cloud. It could be sharing access to my local computer. It could be sharing a pool of Shiny apps that is running in a scalable fashion. So if you acquire the product on the marketplace, when activated through Rosetta Hub, that will tell the platform to make you access the pool of Shiny apps for 2 hours. So all those are, you know, there are ideas of products that we thought of, but there are maybe ideas that we didn't think of. So this delegation of rights on the Meta Cloud can lead to a new ecosystem where people can produce lots and lots of things. So not only those marketplaces that currently exist about images of containers or images of machines are way not enough, but they are also, from a procurement perspective, complicated. You know, you need to be a company to put a machine on Amazon's marketplace. Here, you can do it from your app command line. You produce your stuff, you bundle it, you push it to S3, you create this macro bundle, and call the function sell from the app command line, and it's on the marketplace. And people can search for it. People can rate it, people can put comments on that, and that can create like a dynamics around various things. And the payment, as I said, could be real payment. You can put your ID for PayPal. We will see if we can integrate Bitcoin so that basically the exchange happens even easier. Yeah, so that's mostly it about what I wanted to show you. We will take the Latif questions for like 5 minutes and then we will head to the airport. So please ask me whatever you want for the remaining time. Any questions? So do you see applicability? Please.
Maybe you mentioned this at the very start. There are some predefined virtual machines, but as a user, I can create either the.
There is a starting point, but you can create yours at any point in time. And they appear in the combo box and they are shareable.
As a user, you can create.
You can say snapshots and give a label or a description, and it becomes a new machine on Amazon that appears in
Amazon. The hardware of the machine.
Of course. Basically, when I clicked on launch, so if I go back to the advanced console, that's called the capacity on Amazon. So if I select here machines and I say launch, I pick the credentials for running the machine, and then in the page number 2. You have 2 combo boxes that are important, the one where you choose the image and the one where you choose the capacity. These are the 2 capacities that I authorized for this particular key, but there are keys with tons of capacities. You can mark every single capacity of Amazon. It could be here a machine that runs with 2 terabytes of RAM.
So who authorizes these different machines?
If you put keys from an account that has your credit card, could be anything. It could be any capacity. It could be GPU instances. It could be Hadoop clusters. No restrictions. As soon as you take the risk, if you don't take the risk and use the academic account through the Federation console of Rosetta Hub, then we put limitations by default that can be lifted by the central point of contact of your institution within a certain limits. So if you need to run a GPU instance that's not there for you by default, you go to the CPOC and say, I'd like this. The CPOC will go to the console and say, I authorize this instance. And
so
then you can see.
Will add another.
Exactly.
That the administrator kind of builds.
Exactly. And then you will be able not only to run machine that capacity, but to build tokens for people based on that capacity. And then those capacity, as I said, can be anything from a machine that costs 1 cent, a machine that costs $20 per hour, and that's for 2 terabytes of RAM. That's how it works. The idea of shareability is important. I showed you the link. But once you have keys that allow you to launch machine with the GPU cards, then you can share those keys with other users. You can define a group and say this group can run with these keys.
How easy is it? Do they have to go through the Amazon interface?
No. They need to go to Rosetta Hub and click on this same launch dialog. And they will find the keys that you shared with them.
Those?
This screen here, you see, first thing, what are the keys you are launching with? These are my keys. But if you create keys that are yours and share them with me, they will appear here and I will be able to use them. And you will be billed. That you will pay for me. So basically, it's enough that one person has an active AWS account to allow the entire classroom or to allow the entire department to use it.
But this person will create the options of that machine.
Exactly.
How easy is that?
Very, very easy. The idea is really to really hide all the complexity coming from policies on Amazon. If you'd like to do something like that on Amazon, you need to be an expert. It's really, you need to learn what the IAM is about, you need to learn how to write policies. And then even then, it's not enough, because there's this dimension of having like a social platform with real groups and roles and things like that doesn't exist on Amazon, doesn't exist on any public cloud, actually. So it's easy, and it's meant to be easy, and it's not easy enough. You can think again about how to make it better. So this is really like the starting point of something potentially very big. So we will have, we will be listening and tuning and making things evolve in the direction that, that makes it even easier. That's why we have that interface which is called the basic console, where you don't need to see all these things, machines and containers. You have buttons that you can click. This is a token that I bought from the marketplace. Click, it gives me Jupyter Notebook. That's how it works. Any other question? Yes.
Yeah, it's also easy to extract components out of this ecosystem of Rosetta. For example, download a Docker image.
Of course.
Okay, so
that's a key thing. Everything that happens there is belongs to you. We do the wiring, but we don't put something that basically makes it non-extractable.
Yeah,
in a certain way. This is one important thing. That's another aspect of it. If you go to Google Docs, they give you for free a service for collaborating at the cost of your data and looking at your data. Okay? This is a different model. This is also delivering a service, but it's a private service. It's sandboxed, it's secured for you, but it runs on your own virtual appliances. If the platform Rosetta Hub disappears, you will go directly to Amazon and you'll find your data in S3. You'll find your machine images stored on Amazon's cloud. It's like a facilitator. It's like something that makes it easier for you, but doesn't own anything, doesn't touch your data, and it's basically help you build engines, connect them to data, get something done, expose, share. And that, not only a different model than Google's, designed for privacy, designed for ownership, but it's also something very, very nice for scalability. Because if you go to Google Docs and ask for a spreadsheet that has 10 million columns by 10 million rows, you will not get that, right? But if you do it through the Rosetta Hub spreadsheet, you can, because you pay for the memory. You pay for how much capacity you will be using. So it's delivering services component in an ecosystem where everyone can create a service that can be shared with others. So it's like going to the next level. This is like Dropbox is a layer on top of Amazon that made the sharing of files very easy. This is designed to be like the next level. It's not about sharing files, it's about sharing services, creating services, and interacting using them. And the ideal for us is not only to have researchers and educators and students do that, but to have maybe high school students and anyone being able to create components that interact with open data and provide an interface to look at things, see? So the technology is there, we are kicking with it, it's being kickstarted, so our general availability date is meant to be mid-September this year. The Federation platform is fully operational and we have thousands of people already in there, but the entire platform and with documentation and examples and everything should be expected around mid-September. The company is here. So, yeah, we have received contributions from many people. Contributions in terms of code and ideas. Too many to name them one by one. But more, and it's also very, very important, are leveraging open source technology that is mature, that is tremendously powerful. We haven't written the marketplace from scratch. We haven't written LifeRay from scratch. LifeRay is years and years of work of hundreds of people. You know, it took 10 years to get to where it is. And we are building on that. So basically, I think the leverage that is given to us, just to individual, by that open source, by clouds, by Docker, is tremendous. And I think we will be able to keep going while being not very big and being helped and by ideas from you, by being helped by your contribution into the ecosystem, your shiny apps on the marketplace, and we will see where this takes us to. We don't know what the future will look like, but I believe there is an urge and there is a need to go down these directions. reproducibility is very important, but usable reproducibility is even more important, and this is what this is about. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope you will give it a try, you will play with the accounts you received. If you have questions to us, please email me or Latifa. So the email is an easy one. Here we go. So it's jerry.chi@rosettahub.com. The platform will be presented at UseR. If you are there, please come and see us. It's going to be not the last day, the previous day, at 11 a.m. It will be presented at Strata, New York, the next one. So we will see how everything goes, but we would love to engage with you. We would love to have your ideas or your comments or your feedback on anything you have seen today or you will discover while working with this. Thanks a lot for your attention.